Good morning. Good morning, everyone. How are you this morning? I hope that you are well this morning. I hope you had a good night's sleep and you are well rested on this beautiful Sunday morning that the Lord has allowed us to see. Today, we have set aside this opportunity to celebrate the day of Pentecost. So today we're going to be talking about Pentecost. But first, let me introduce myself. I am Valarie Oliver, founding pastor of First Liberty Baptist Church in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. We are not your traditional Baptist church. We are not your typical Baptist church. We are all inclusive. This is God's church. All are welcome. We are not concerned about your race, nor your ethnicity, black, white, yellow, straight, gay, or wherever you're from, what neighborhood you live in. We just love you and we want you to know that Jesus loves you just as you are. And so come on and worship with me this morning. I want to say happy birthday first to those who celebrated a birthday today or any day in the month of May. Happy birthday from First Liberty Church to you. We love you with all of our hearts and we wish you many, 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 many more. Now come on now and worship with me. This morning on this beautiful day of Pentecost. It's a beautiful day of Pentecost. Let's worship Him. Let's worship Him for the promise of the Holy Spirit. Miss y'all.
You are the fire, we are the temple. You are the voice, we are your song. You are our God, we are your people. You are the light, we stand in awe.
want the Lord to send His Spirit, and that's what the day of Pentecost is all about. God sending His Spirit. Have you received it this morning? If you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you have received the Holy Spirit. Amen. Listen, I'm not going to hold you long this morning. We are going to go on into the message. Our message this morning will come from Acts, the 17th chapter. Acts chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. If you will, follow along with me. And I'm reading the NIV. Acts, the 17th chapter, verses 1 through 7. Read along with me. When Paul and his companions had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue. As was his custom, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and proving that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. "This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Messiah," he said. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and quite a few prominent women. But other Jews were jealous, so they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. They rushed to Jason's house to search for Paul and Silas in order to bring them out to the crowd. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some other believers before the city officials, shouting, "These men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here, and Jason has welcomed them into his house. They're all defying Caesar's decrees, saying that there is another king, one called Jesus." Amen. Bless the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Dear God in heaven, we thank you so much for your word, for it is a light unto our feet and a lamp unto our pathway. Lord, we ask that you would bless us this morning, and we continue to pray for those who are fighting COVID-19 symptoms, who are in the hospital, who are on ventilators, those who have even lost loved ones, Lord. We ask that you would give them peace that passes all understanding. And Lord, touch now with your healing power. Let there be healing in their bodies, Lord, in their minds, in their hearts, in their emotions. Lord, heal, Lord. Heal our land right now, Lord. We need you, Lord. If there ever was a time we needed you, Lord, it's now. Lord, heal. Heal our land. Oh, heal us, Lord. Help us, Lord. I used to hear the old folks say in the traditional church, if you can't say nothing else, just say, "Lord, help." Lord, help. And you know just what we mean. You know just what we're trying to say. You know just what we're going through. Lord, help. And Lord, as we approach your word, I pray that we will approach it carefully. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Let me decrease and you increase, Lord. Use me as an instrument in your service. It is in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. Ooh. If there ever was a time we needed the Lord, it's now. We always need him. We always have needed him, and we always will. But oh, we need him in a special way now. Our country is in turmoil. Oh, we're in trouble. But the Lord knows all about it. The Lord knows all about it. Keep your head up. Keep your head up, saints. And we're going to continue to move forward. Nothing will stop us. Nothing. Verse 6 of our text, the second portion of verse 6. We would like to call it 6B, if you will. It says, these men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here. I would like for you to meditate with me for a moment from the subject, power in the promise. Power in the promise. As I mentioned earlier, today is the day we have set aside to celebrate the day of Pentecost. Pentecost is the promise that God had given to Joel to deliver to the people of Israel, Joel the prophet. And he said in Joel that he would pour out his spirit upon all flesh. And today is the day that we celebrate that day, the promise fulfilled. God did exactly what he said he would do, and we call it the day of Pentecost. When the Lord poured out his spirit, he said, I'm going to pour my spirit out on all flesh. And that he did. Pente, the Greek pente, means 50. 50. It's 50 days after Jesus' resurrection. 50 days. If you would go back to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you remember that he walked around on the earth for 40 days in his resurrected body, and he showed himself to his disciples, proving that he was alive. And then on Ascension Day, which was last Thursday, not this past Thursday, but Thursday before, he was ascended back to heaven. He ascended back to heaven, and as the disciples saw him going up, a cloud hid him in the sky. He ascended, and no one has seen him since, but he is coming back, and he is here in spirit, because 10 days after Ascension Day, he sent his Holy Spirit. He had promised the disciples that he would not leave us as orphans. He would not leave us alone, that he would send another comforter, an advocate, someone to walk alongside us, and it would be him in his spirit. It would be Jesus himself in the form of the Holy Spirit. And the moment we receive Jesus as our Lord and our Savior, we receive the Holy Spirit. Now, being infilled with the Holy Spirit and indwelled with the Holy Spirit are two different things, and that's a different sermon. And so we did receive the Spirit of God when we accepted Jesus as our Lord and our Savior. On the day of Pentecost, 10 days, which made it 50 days after the resurrection, he poured out his spirit. The promise has been fulfilled. God is faithful to his word. He always has been, and he always will be. He's faithful to his word. And so, my sisters and my brothers, after Pentecost, the disciples went to work. They went to work performing miracles and signs and wonders. They caused the lame to walk, the blind to see, the mute to talk, the deaf ears to open. Everything that Jesus did, they did. They even raised the dead. And so the disciples went to work because they were filled with the Holy Spirit. After the day of Pentecost, they went to work filled with the Holy Spirit, and they did all kinds of wonders and miracles, and they proclaimed the gospel of Jesus Christ and his resurrection. Now the apostles and the disciples went to work, but they were working under the power of the Holy Spirit. And so was Paul and Silas. You might say, Paul? Paul wasn't of the original 12. How did Paul get to be an apostle of Jesus Christ? Paul had an encounter with Jesus. And when you have an encounter with Jesus, I tell you, your life will never be the same. God changed Paul. Paul was mean toward Christians. Paul would imprison Christians. Paul hated Christians. He was a devout Pharisee, a religious person. He wasn't filled with the Holy Spirit. He didn't know the Lord. He didn't know God. There are a lot of people like that today, you know, modern day Pharisees. They just go through the motion. They just go through the ritualistic duties and responsibilities Sunday by Sunday, Sunday after Sunday, but they don't really know the Lord the way they ought to. Paul didn't know the Lord. He was just a devout religious Pharisee, and he went about hating Christians, and he imprisoned them, and he had them beaten, and he was mean to them. But oh, one day he had an encounter with Jesus. He really met Jesus, and his life was changed forever. And so, yes, Paul became an apostle. Jesus appointed him himself. He sent Paul himself. And so, yes, Paul and Silas were apostles, were disciples, and Paul was an apostle, rather. And Paul was a missionary. He was a missionary. He was a church planter. He went around planting churches, and we call them missionary journeys. And he would go to this place and he would plant a church. And then he would go to that place and he would plant a church. And he would go here and he would go all around and he would plant churches. He was a missionary. And this, my sisters and brothers, brings me to where we are right now in our text. While Paul was on one of his missionary journeys, he and his companions passed through Amphipolis, Apollonia, and they came to Thessalonica. And there was a synagogue there, a church. And the scripture tells us, as was his custom, he went into the synagogue. And he reasoned with the people in the synagogue, with Pharisees, one of the people he had once been. You know, the same people who persecuted Christians. Now he's a Christian and he's talking to the Pharisees, trying to reason with them now. He's become one of us. And now he's trying to reason with the religious folk. But the point I want to make here in this particular text, in this verse, is that it was custom that he went into the synagogue. It was custom that he went to church. Just like Jesus, Paul went to church on a regular basis. Don't get too comfortable at home, my sisters and my brothers, wherever you worship, whatever church home you have. Don't get too comfortable at home. We are going back to church. We are going back to assemble ourselves together. The Lord said, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together. Now, we had to do it for a while because it made sense. God gave us wisdom also. You go when it's safe. And so we will return to church very soon. And so my sisters and my brothers, don't you think that it's not necessary to go to church? There are many who are unchurched today, as we would say. There are many who do not go to church today. And believe me, I understand. I understand. But I'm here to plead with you. If you have stopped going to church, maybe you stopped a long time ago. Maybe you stopped when you were a teenager. Maybe you stopped going for some reason. A lot of times people are hurt in the church. They get judged and they're examined and talked about because of who they love and who they are or how they dress. You see, and it makes people not want to go to church. I get it. I get it. But please, I beg you, do not let what man has done turn you away from God and from God's word. And God says, assemble yourselves together. So find you somewhere where you feel comfortable and go to church. Go to church. And so Paul went to church on a regular basis. It was his custom. And in verse 3 tells us that he was explaining and proving to them, to the Pharisees, that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. It had been prophesied, you see. And he said, this Jesus that I'm talking about, he's the Messiah. No, I thought about it when I read that, and I said to myself, how did he prove to them that Jesus is the Messiah? He's just sitting there, and he's talking to them and teaching, and they're having a discussion. And I imagine there was some debate at some point in time. You know, because that's what religious folk like to do. They like to play word games and they go back and forth with you, you see. They don't hear God. They don't listen to God. Religious folk don't hear God. Only spiritual people hear God. And here Paul is filled with the Holy Spirit. And he's talking to these religious folk, these Pharisees. And I'm asking myself, how did he prove to them? Because they didn't believe Jesus was the Messiah. Remember, they're the ones who turned him over to Roman soldiers to be crucified. They called it blasphemy when Jesus said that he was the Son of God. And that was one of the reasons they turned him over to be crucified. The Pharisees, the Jews, church folks. And so here Paul is trying to talk to these people and tell them that Jesus is the Messiah, the one you crucified. How did he prove that to them? Well, let me say it this way to you, my sisters and my brothers. When the Lord is using you, you have no idea what God is doing in people's hearts. When God is using you, you have no idea how God is dealing with those around you. When you open your mouth, you have no idea the power that God is using that's transferring from you to another person. The power of the Holy Spirit can change a person's whole life by the very words you speak into their lives. The power of God. See, it wasn't really Paul who proved to them that Jesus was the Messiah. It was the Holy Spirit working through him. It was the power of God. Ooh, the Holy Spirit. Ooh, today is the day of Pentecost. I'm so glad Jesus sent his Spirit. And he's working today through you and through me. So it wasn't really Paul who proved to them that Jesus was the Messiah. Paul, under his own power, can prove nothing. But under the power of the Holy Spirit, he is persuasive. He is convincing. He is all-powerful and all-knowing, and he can turn a person's life around. He can change minds. He can change hearts. He can change lives through you and through me. So this is how Paul was able to prove to them that Jesus is the Messiah, because it was the Holy Spirit working through Paul. And so some of the Jews who heard Paul, they were persuaded. They were persuaded. You see what I'm saying? They were persuaded. And they joined Paul and Silas. They became disciples. Ooh. Talking about Pharisees, religious folks. They really got to know Jesus as Paul introduced him as the Messiah. And they joined Paul and Silas, and so did a large number of other people who were not Jews, who were not so-called religious folk, who didn't go to church. These were people who didn't go to church. Greeks didn't go to church, but they were in the synagogue that day listening. You never know who God is going to send to church and who God is going to place to cross your path. You never know who God is going to send to you. And whatever you say to them matters. See, because if you let God use you, I tell you, he will do things in that person's life. And so a large number of people, and some had already come to Christ. That's why they were at church. They were God-fearing Greeks, the text tells us. So at one time, they were not going to church. They did not believe, but they came to believe. And I imagine it happened sometime after the day of Pentecost, because they saw all this power. They saw all these miracles. And then they started believing the word of God. You see, the miracles and the signs and wonders accompanied the word of God. And that's what made people believe the word of God. That's what made people believe all the wonders and miracles they saw. And so these people who had not been going to church after the day of Pentecost, when power came into this earth, then that's when they believed. And they said also that a few prominent women believed. See, people recognize power when they see it. People know where the power is. They know who's just playing around and playing games with them. They know a spirit-filled person when they hear one. They know when somebody stands up in the pulpit and they're just speaking words. Paul said elsewhere in another verse in the Bible, he said, we preach with power, not just with mere words, but we preach with power. So you can get up there and people can just talk or do a speech. But it's not proclamation. It's not power. It's not words empowered by the Spirit of God, the power of God. They're just up there talking loud. That's all. And people who have the Holy Spirit living within him can recognize the difference. We can recognize the difference. See, people know power when they see it. They know where the power is. So this brings me to a question this morning for you. What do people see when they are in your presence? What do people see? Do they see the power of God in you, or do they see you? How do you leave people feeling once you've been in their presence? Do you leave them feeling as if if that's how a Christian is, I don't really want to be one. If that's what they have in church, I don't want to go. Or are you attractive? Or are you really the light that draws people? Are you really the love that draws people? Are you the salt of the earth, the flavor of the earth? You know, people come back for flavor. People come back to something that tastes good. If you go to Popeye's, and I've not been going to Popeye's lately, by the way, But when people go to the drive through at Popeye's, they would say, "Welcome back to Popeye's. You've been there before." And they know you've been there before because they know that their chicken tastes good. Don't talk about the chicken sandwich. The chicken tastes good. They say, "Welcome back to Popeye's." See, so the flavor, you are to be flavored with salt. That's why Jesus said you are the salt of the earth. You are to draw people, not to you, but to Christ. To Christ. And so people don't need to see you. People don't need to see me. They need to see Jesus. People need to see Jesus. Who do people see when they are in your presence? And so that's something to ponder. That's something to think about. So some people who heard Paul followed him and Silas. But in verse 5, it tells us that some of the Jews didn't feel quite that way. Some of them were jealous. Ooh, you better beware of jealous people. Be careful of jealous people. I tell you, they'll try to ruin you. I tell you, watch it around jealous people. Jealous people will try to ruin your life. They'll try to ruin your reputation. But God has a way of making them look like a fool. God has a way of making them look bad. He'll turn that thing around. They're trying to make you look bad, but God has a way of turning that thing around and making it work for your good. They've talked about you so much that by the time God elevates you and lifts you up, everybody knows your name. Everybody always knows who you are when you got people talking about you. See. So thank them. Thank your haters and the jealous folk that mention your name so much. They can't keep your name out of their mouths. So that when God elevates you, they already know you. Thank you for the advertisement. Thank you for the recognition. See, what the devil meant to harm us, God meant it for our good. But you watch jealous folk. They'll try to hurt you. So verse 5 says the Jews were jealous, some of them. Not every one of them enjoyed Paul and Silas. Not every one of them enjoyed Paul's company and Paul's words. See, they'll try to ruin your life. So what they did, my sisters and my brothers, these jealous folk, they rounded up some bad characters. They rounded up some bad characters and they formed a mob and they started a riot in the city. And they rushed into this fellow's house named Jason. I guess Paul and Silas maybe had stayed there. You know, hospitality was big back then because they didn't have a lot of hotels and inns, as they might call it, you know. Welcoming people into your home back in that day was big. Hospitality was big. That's one of the problems with Sodom and Gomorrah. The reason why God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, because they were not nice to strangers. They raped them. Yeah, the men went over to Lot's house to rape them instead of allowing them to enjoy the hospitality that Lot was showing them. They wanted to rape them. It had nothing to do with love and consensual affection between two adults. See, the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah has nothing to do with the LGBTQ+ community. But unlearned and uninformed people always use that scripture to beat up the LGBTQ+ community. And that is not what it was about at all. Study to show yourself approved and stop telling lies on God. God did not say that. And so Jason must have taken in Paul and Silas and let them stay there. So this mob went to Jason's house to look for Paul and Silas. They wanted to bring them out into the crowd, you see. They wanted to try to make them look bad, just like jealous folk do. See? They want to make them look bad. Some people, my brothers and my sisters, are not going to like you when the Spirit of God rests upon you. I'm telling you, it's the scripture says, when you decide you're going to live a God-fearing life, you will be persecuted. People are just not going to like you for no reason. But Jesus said, don't worry about it. They hated me and they hated prophets before me. Simply because they preached the word. Simply because they were doing what God had told them to do. They were saying what God told them to say. And people didn't like what God wanted to say to them. People didn't like. Some people like to shoot the messenger. And some people did just that. But many of God's prophets were killed. Because they didn't like the message. Messages of doom. But it was only because of their own behavior. And God was just trying to get them to see him and focus on him and stop all the idolatry and all the witchcraft and idol worship and all this temple prostitution and all this foolishness and come back to him, the one and only true God. And they didn't want to hear that. They didn't want to hear that. And they killed God's prophet. They kill God's prophets. And so some people will just not like you because the Spirit of God rests upon you and dwells within you. Some will be drawn to your power and some will resist you. But they're not resisting you. Don't take it personal. They're not resisting you. They are resisting God. They think they're resisting you, but they are resisting God, not you. So don't you feel bad about them. And so they are searching for Paul and Silas, and they didn't find them. Verse 6 tells us they didn't find them. They couldn't find them. God has a way of hiding you. He'll hide you from your enemies. Psalm 91. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. When you're in God's presence, when you're in the shadow of the Almighty, when God is covering you and he is your refuge, you are in safety. You're in the arms of safety. And God will hide you from the foolishness of this world. He'll hide you from the chaos of this world. And somehow, some way, through it all, you'll have peace. And that's why they call it peace that passes all understanding. And so God hid them some kind of way, and they couldn't find Paul and Silas. You see, so what they did was they drug Jason out of his home. They drug him out and brought him before the city officials. And they started shouting. They drug out Jason and some of the people who were also followers of Jesus, and they brought them along with Jason, and they started shouting. They said, these men who have caused trouble all over the world. Talking about Paul and Silas. I'm going to get to where I'm going in a minute. They were talking about Paul and Silas. They said, these men who have caused trouble, said they were staying here at Jason's house. But the point I want to make here is when they said, these men who have caused trouble all over the world. All over the world. You let that sink in. Not all over the city. Not community, not all over the state, not all over the country, all over the world, as it was at that time, all over the world. Now that's power. That's power. When you can cause trouble all over the world. The King James version puts it this way. It says, they have turned the world upside down. Not in a bad way, not through violence, not through rioting like these people were doing, not through trouble in a bad way, but trouble in a good way. Shaking up the establishment, shaking up the powers that be, you know, breaking it up, breaking it down. That's what has to happen in America today, you know. See, the establishment has to be shaken up. And you can't shake up the establishment by doing the same old thing over and over and over again. How does looting and stealing help the cause? How does burning down buildings help the cause? Yes, we're angry. Yes, we need to get attention. And some people feel like, well, what else can we do? Nobody hears us. Nobody listens. We try to be nonviolent, but they're still violent toward us. I get their point. I'm never condoning violence, but I do understand. What can we do to shake up the establishment? I'm going to tell you in a minute. I'm going to tell you in a minute. You got power. You have the power to do it. You have power. See, they said there's trouble all over the world. This was good trouble. Elijah Cummings said it best. Get in trouble. Good trouble. You know, stand for social justice. Stand for racial justice. Stand for justice. You might ruffle up some feathers and some people are going to get mad at you and some people are not going to like you. That's all right. Who cares? You know, because something has to give. Enough is enough. You got to shake up some stuff. You can't change and go in a new direction doing the same old thing. So they got in good trouble. It was worldwide. That's how powerful God is when he works through you. One person. Martin Luther King was but one person. And look, we are still benefiting from what he did, from what God did through him. Rosa Parks, one person. We are still benefiting from what she did. She took a stand by taking a seat and didn't move. And we are still benefiting from it. So many names I can call. We are still benefiting. See, my own mother, my grandmother, my great-grandmother, all of our ancestors, we are still benefiting from their strength. From their face. And we must keep it moving. But we got to start doing something different. And you just hold on. We got to start doing something different. But the power of God will lead and guide us, I tell you. He'll tell us what that different thing is. Rosa Parks didn't even know what was going to happen that day. She just decided she wasn't going to get up. At the moment, that wasn't her plan when she boarded the bus. But it was God's plan. Martin Luther King didn't set out to be a civil rights leader. He was a preacher. He was a pastor of a church, and he saw injustice, and he said, no, I'm not going to just stand here and not say anything. I'm going to speak out. And he ended up being a great a civil rights leader whose name will never be forgotten. He didn't set out to do that. He didn't plan to do that, but God did. All they did was listen to the Lord. All they did was listen to the power within them. All they did was listen to the Spirit of God who had indwelled them. And they were led by the Holy Spirit, filled with the Holy Spirit. And when it didn't even seem like God was doing anything in them, God was working big time. Rosa Parks was just tired and she didn't feel like getting up. She didn't think it was the Holy Spirit. But you never know what God is doing in you and what he'll do to change this world. You never know what the power of God will do. The day of Pentecost is a great day. And we don't know the exact date. Who cares about dates? People get hooked up on dates. Well, Christmas wasn't December 25th. How do you know that day of Pentecost was on this day? How do you know the resurrection was on? Nobody cares about the date. As long as we acknowledge it and we celebrate it. As long as we celebrate it. See. And this mob brought Jason and the fellow believers before these people. See. Because they had caused trouble, Paul and Silas, all over the world. Your haters got trouble on their hands. If you got enough power to change the world, your haters don't realize the kind of trouble they need. So they said, here's Jason. Jason welcomed them into his house. They welcomed these troublemakers. Talking about Paul and Silas. Jason welcomed Paul and Silas, these troublemakers, into his home. And then look what they said. Woo. They said, they are defying Caesar's decrees. They're saying that there is another king, one called Jesus. See, Caesar was a dictator. There wasn't supposed to be anyone above him. He was the Roman emperor at the time. The Roman emperor, the Roman government was oppressive. And Caesar was a dictator. See, that sounds familiar. That really sounds familiar. Somebody knows what I'm talking about. That sounds familiar. See, there is somebody who is supposed to be leading our democracy in this country, yet wants to be a dictator. He wants to rule the world. He wants to be a dictator. See. But what these people, these dictators and Caesar and all of these people who want all the power and don't want to listen to the people, they forget that there is a God in heaven. They act as if there is no God. They say they're Christians. They talk about praying. Their prayers don't get any further than the ceiling. They talk about worshiping God and going to church and all this and that, just talking. But they don't really know God. They don't know God. They act as if there is no God. But there is a God who sits high and looks low. And this God is higher than Caesar. This God is greater than any dictator. And his power, this God, who's greater than any dictator in this world, the power of this God rests upon you. He is within you, he is upon you, and he is with you. As I come to a close, my sisters and my brothers, let me encourage you this morning. You can turn this world upside down. It's not you, it's God. You can turn this world upside down. We need the power of God. How does God operate in this world? How does God operate in this earth? It's through his people. God is not in flesh and blood walking on this earth. Jesus has ascended back to heaven and sent his Holy Spirit. And his Holy Spirit lives in you and in me, those who have accepted him and received him as our Savior. Now we are his hands and his feet. We are the body of Christ. We are the flesh and blood of God on this earth. Woo! God is going to work through you and through me. We need power in this world. That's how we're going to change. That's how the establishment is going to break up. See, that's how we're going to make good trouble by the power of God. And when they bother you, they don't understand that they're bothering God. When they're jealous of you, they don't understand that they're messing with God's people. When they're persecuting you, they don't understand they're persecuting God. The same Paul was persecuting Christians, and Jesus stopped him on the road to Damascus. And he said, Saul, name wasn't Paul just yet. Saul called his name twice. You're in trouble if God called your name twice. You know how your parents would call your name twice? And they call you by your whole name? Not Val, Valerie. Valerie? I said, uh-oh. Saul, why do you persecute me? See, he didn't say, why are you persecuting my people? Why are you persecuting my disciples? He said, why are you persecuting me? That's how personal he takes it. He takes it personal when people bother you. When they bother you, they're bothering him. And this morning, he's talking to these people who are supposed to be leaders, dictators. See, 45 in them up in the Senate and all these other people. He's asking them the same question. Why are you persecuting me? You're persecuting my people. You're mistreating my people. You are oppressive. You are allowing killers and murderers to go scot-free. There is no justice. Why are you persecuting me? And they better be listening. They better be listening. I'm moving on to a close. You can turn this world upside down. The power of God working through you can change the world. It's the power we need today. The power of the Holy Spirit can do some things through you and through me that have never been done before. Martin Luther King had never done what he did before. Rosa Parks had never done what she did. Sojourner Truth had never done what she did. Harriet Tubman had never done what she did. Thurgood Marshall had never done what he did. This was new stuff. And just like it was new for them, it's going to be new for you and for me. Something that God has for us to do is going to be something that has never been done before. We don't know what it is, but God knows. You better hear me this morning. I'm telling you, be listening. Be listening. Don't be stubborn and hard-hearted like some of these people who are in leadership positions. Don't be stubborn and stiff-necked. Listen. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Jesus has kept his promise and has sent the Holy Spirit to you and to me. And we need to be listening. God has a mission. Paul had a missionary journey. We got a missionary journey. We might not have to plant a church or build a church, and we might. But whatever God has for us to do, let's be listening. See, we can change the world by allowing the Lord to use us and do things through us that have never been done before. That's how change comes about. You want to see something different? We got to do something different. These men have caused trouble all over the world, they say. And listen to this part, my final point. Verse 6. And it says, and now they have come here. Talking about Paul and Silas, they're shaking up the world. Now they have come here. Now they're here in Thessalonica. What are they doing here? Now they're here. I detect maybe a little bit of fear. These people here who have shaken up the world and doing all these miracles and all this stuff that we've never seen before have come here. Ooh, tell you. See, there's a reason why some people don't like you. There's a reason why fear. Fear. Sometimes it's jealousy, but jealousy is just about fear that you're going to be better than them or something like that, something crazy. Something you don't even think about. Something you don't even be aware of. It ain't talking about you for nothing behind your back. You don't even know it. You don't even know why. You know. But these men have now come here with this power. These men who have upset the world, who have turned the world upside down, have come here. Listen closely, and I'm coming to a close. You are here now. You are here now. You. For such a time as this, what time is it? Racial injustice. Prevalent. Bold-faced. Now they feel because of the dictatorship and the racial leadership, the racist leadership in this country, they feel a boldness now. To be seen and heard with their hatred and not care. Chauvin leaned down with his knee on Mr. Floyd's neck with his hands in his pocket like he was sitting at the park somewhere watching the birds in the trees, just sitting there casually. This man is crying out for his life. And he just got his neck, look like to me, when I watched the video, like he pressed even harder. And he just sitting there on his knees with his knee in the man's throat, choking the man to death with his hands in his pocket. Your life ain't nothing to me. You don't mean nothing to me. Really, I really wish you'd shut up. And it looked like he was pressing hard to me. They feel a boldness now that they can do this because they've gotten away with it so many times. And now you have a president in the White House who calls them good people. Calls them good people. There's healthcare injustice. Economic injustice. You are here for such a time as this. This bold-faced injustice. All of this injustice that we're seeing today where nobody cares anymore if you see it. The camera's shining right in his face. People are videoing with their phones, and you think he cares? No, because we got a president yet that thinks he's a good person. Why are you here for such a time as this? You say this world is in chaos. This world is in turmoil. But you're here. And you're here for a reason. Gender inequality, housing inequality, sexism, economic inequality. You are here for such a time as this, and you are here for a reason. You are here at this time in your life and me for this time in my life for a purpose. You're supposed to be here. You're supposed to be seeing all of this. For a reason. See, you're prepared to be here. You have the power of God who has prepared you. You don't know it. But you have the power of God who has prepared you for such a time as this. Well, he's letting you know this morning. See, the world is in turmoil. Yes. But you're here. You're here in this world full of chaos. You're here. And the power of God is here in you. In Christ, you have the power to turn this thing around. You got power in you, my sisters. And my brothers, you have power to change this world. You have power to turn the world upside down. Christ in you can turn this government around, can turn America around. Not by violence. Not by destruction, but by the Spirit of God. The song at the beginning says, not by my own power, not by my power, my might, but by the Spirit. Said, by your Spirit, oh God. You have the power to do it. This is the promise. My sisters and my brothers, that God made to each and every one of us who has received Jesus. This is the promise of power, the promise of the Holy Spirit. What are we going to do with all of this power that we have? The same power that Paul and Silas had, we have. The same power that Peter had, we have. The same power that Martin Luther King had, we have. The same power that Sojourner Truth and Rosa Parks and Harriet Tubman and all of our ancestors and others who have gone on before us, that same power they had, you have, and we have. We are in this together. What are we going to do with all this power? Let's listen to God and do what he tells us to do. Amen. There is power in this promise. The promise of the Holy Spirit, and he is here. He lives in you. You are powerful. Whoo, you are one to be reckoned with if you would just realize. Turn this world upside down. Be a troublemaker. A good troublemaker. There's power in you. power in the promise. After God has encouraged us so, because he really encouraged my heart also with this message. But there might be somebody who does not know this power. There might be somebody who does not know Jesus, who has never met him for themselves. And if that is you this morning, now is your time. Yesterday is gone, never to return. Tomorrow has not even gotten here yet, and it is not promised. But you do have now. You do have this very moment. Is there one? Is there two? Is there three? Are there many? Bible says that many followed Paul. Who they were following was Jesus. Through the words Paul spoke. This morning I extend to you the invitation to Christ. All you have to do is just realize that, you know, hey, I need it. I can't do it by myself. It's too much. This world is too big for me. All you need is Jesus. And just realize, Lord, I know you died for me. I know you shed your blood for me. You were crucified. You died. You were buried. And then you rose again on the third day. You walked this earth for 40 days. And then you ascended back to heaven. And then 10 days later, on the 50th day, the day of Pentecost, after you rose from the dead, you sent your power to this earth. You want power? Receive Jesus today. Just say, Lord, save me. Forgive me for all of my sins. The blood washes us clean of all sin and sins, past, present, and future. And if you pray that prayer, let us know. We want to pray with you and we want to pray for you. And we want you to come worship with us. We're going to be returning to church pretty soon. We want you to worship with us. But if you have somewhere else you would like to worship, then please go where you feel comfortable. We would love to have you at First Liberty. We are the place where love fulfills the law. Be who you are. You are welcomed and affirmed. So we hope that you receive Christ and this power. That's what we need. It's not going to be stealing Adidas tennis shoes, breaking into Target and stealing. I saw a guy, when they broke in there, he got him a basket. I'm not going to go there. But I pray that you receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. And he'll change your world. He'll change your life. And then you can change the world. God bless you and God keep you. Happy Pentecost. Happy day of Pentecost. God bless you and God keep you. And if it be the will of God, I'll see you next Sunday. Same time, same place. 11 o'clock Central Standard Time in the Baton Rouge LGBT group. If you miss it, don't have Facebook or you have friends who don't have social media, you can send them to the YouTube channel, First Liberty Church YouTube channel. And they can see all the uploaded Bible studies and sermons. So now you be safe. And remember, you have power. There's power in the promise. I'll see you next time. Thank you.